Hey guys, welcome to this video about ladder anxiety. So let's talk a little bit about what anxiety is, then we're going to talk a little bit about a couple terms of psychology. Trust me, I'm not going to go too much into it, but these are very important because I'm going to refer back to them quite a bit. And then finally, I'm going to give you guys three different plans on how to get rid of ladder anxiety completely. To start off, who am I? I'm NotParadox. I've been doing Heroes of the Storm content for, 2.5 years. I've been doing video game content for a while. I've got a background in psychology, neuropsychology. In fact, I'm about 3 months away from being an official psychologist, which is pretty exciting. I'm excited about that. With that being said, I do want to share a little bit about this. I've done a lot of psychology videos, but I kind of took a break on those for a bit because school's been getting really hectic, work's been getting really hectic, and I just got a little bit of free time in between a couple things, and someone asked if I had a video on this. I've talked about this a lot, but I haven't had a structured video on it. So with all that being said, let's get right into it because I want to try to keep this video short. I've recorded a couple times. It's been rather long. So to start off, anxiety. What is it? Anxiety is just an apprehension about something that can create negative feelings, negative symptoms, things like nausea, things like uncomfortability, as well as increased stress. And then stress can also create anxiety, and it actually works. They work together to make things even worse. So if you are really stressful or really stressed out anyways, you're going to have increased anxiety about smaller things. If you have a lot of anxiety about something, you're going to have increased stress. And if you have long periods of time with both, it's going to work off of each other, and both of them are going to continue to increase. So the goal here is to make sure that your hobby is not filled with anxiety. You want to do ranked because you are excited to do it. You're excited to learn if you're improving. But at the same time, you don't want to have your hobby, which is something that's supposed to reduce your stress, increase the amount of stress that you're having, because you want to get home from work and reduce your stress. And this is what this video is for. So number one, the first thing that you guys need to know is hardiness. Hardiness is a term that you've probably heard before. It's in every single program. Psych 101 is going to learn it, all the way to management, as well as I've even heard a history professor talk about it. Hardiness is a very simple term that just means your ability to handle stress. For example, if you've ever been in a situation where you felt really stressed and someone said, "Oh, well, I don't know how you can be stressed about that. I did something like that the other day, but I did blank, blank, and blank on top of it. And I wasn't stressed, so you shouldn't be stressed." Well, the problem is that on that particular topic, they have more hardiness than you do. They can handle that stress much, much better than you can. That doesn't mean that you're weaker, because hardiness is a little bit fluid in a way, where again, the more stressed you are about some things, it makes other things worse. But at the same time, the more we handle stressful situations, the more we're going to improve our hardiness. And hardiness is also a little bit topic specific as well. So for example, when I first was building a computer, I was putting in it was a radiator, and I went to screw it in, and I didn't realize that the radiator was broken, so I ended up breaking my case while screwing in the radiator and didn't even realize it. So I had to replace both the case and the radiator. Well, naturally, I'm going to be more stressed the next time that I'm building a computer because I had a bad situation. But then after I built 40 computers, I dealt with it, and that brings up self-efficacy, which we'll talk about a little bit later. But the goal is the more you handle that's stressful, the more you can handle stress in those topics, as well as in the variety of stress in general. People have said that there's good stress and bad stress, and good stress is essentially stress that you know you can handle. Bad stress is stress that you don't know that you can handle. And the longer that you have bad stress, the worse it is. The more you have good stress, the more bad stress you can handle, as well as the more you can handle good stress. And it's just actually surprisingly healthy for you. There is a variety of studies on how healthy stress can be for you, as long as it's stress that you know you can handle. With that being said, I'm going to get into self-efficacy. I keep saying, well, what stress can you handle? Well, self-efficacy is a form of self-esteem. And there are three forms of self-esteem: self-esteem, self-efficacy, and self-image. But we will only be talking about self-efficacy today, which is a form of self-esteem that was created by Albert Bandura, if I remember correctly, a psychologist that should still be alive teaching at Harvard University. Really cool dude. He actually created this or worked on this thing called modeling that I'm not going to get into it. That's for a whole different video. Anyways, so self-efficacy is our subconscious belief in our abilities. So, for example, if you are not sure that you can do something, you're going to be nervous about it. You're going to be anxious about it, especially if there's anything that rides on it. Let's say, for example, your rank. If you lose, you're going to lose rank. If you don't believe in yourself subconsciously, then you are going to be nervous to go into ranked. So self-efficacy is going to be extremely important. You can improve your self-efficacy by doing the things that you are going to be doing, or by preparing to do those things. For example, there was actually a study done on crows that determined that crows were more, they were more confident in doing a task if they had made a tool to do that task. And I know that sounds really weird, but they found these crows that were using tools to do things, and they found that crows were more confident to try something that they couldn't do if they had a tool to do it. And we kind of do that same thing subconsciously. If we've learned a new tool, we're more excited and less nervous about something because we've learned that new tool that should help us out, which is why I do a lot of videos about teaching combos and stuff. I did that entire series of 100 to 0 combos to try to help people gain a new tool that they didn't have before. And so all of that is what you're going to be doing to improve your self-efficacy, that subconscious belief in your own abilities. And so with that being said, let's get into the three-step process. These are three separate plans. Any one of these plans can make it to where you don't have ladder anxiety. And I guess I never explained what ladder anxiety is. Ladder anxiety is that anxiety that builds up by trying to queue up. You can see, I don't want to queue up. I don't want to ready up because I'm worried. Well, there's a wide variety of reasons why you might be worried, but anxiety is also really hard to pinpoint, which is why it's better to start working on these things so that you can improve and not have to worry about that ladder anxiety. As you can see, I have a decent win rate, but I don't play a lot. In fact, I don't play enough that I decayed back down to Diamond 5. I'm Masters the majority of the seasons. This is the only season that I haven't reached Masters in a long time. Ever since I carried myself up from a lower rank, I've not been up to Masters since then. I've been at Masters since then, and I decayed down two or three seasons in a row and then was able to make myself back to Masters again. But in this case, I haven't taken the time to get back up to Masters after my decay. Whatever. Random excuses. Doesn't really matter. Why are people nervous? Could be a million things. Maybe you don't want to lose rank because you don't want people to see you in a lower rank. Maybe you don't want to lose rank because you're going to feel like you're getting worse. Maybe you don't want to lose rank because you just have a goal that's higher, and every time that you lose, you're getting further and further away from your goal. All of those are reasons that you might have ladder anxiety, and we're here to try to get rid of that. So to start off, I'm going to explain plan number one: improve your self-efficacy. If you improve your subconscious's belief in your ability, then you're going to be less nervous going into really anything. So improving yourself, this is proven again in a million studies. You go in with tools, you're going to be more confident in those tools. So to improve your self-efficacy, there are two major things. One, learn new tools. Practice things in try mode. Go in try mode, try out new combos, try out stutter stepping, try out all of that stuff, try out different builds, then go into the game. If you're playing on other games like Overwatch, there's a try mode in that as well. Just practice. Number two, just get in there and do it. Play ranked over and over and over and over, and eventually your subconscious is going to go, wait, we can move up in rank, we can move down in rank, we know what to do, we can do this before, we're not nervous about this. The people that play 200, 300, 400 games a season are not nervous at all, it's just another thing. They log in, they click ready, and they just go for it. They're not worried about it. They're not worried about moving up or down, because they know that they'll eventually move up further. And when I'm teaching people and coaching people, oftentimes I say, you're not going to be able to win every game. You're going to lose 30% of your games, you're going to win 30% of your games, 40% you might have even a little bit to do with it. But you can't be nervous because you need to win a percentage to move up because it's going to go up and down. So you need to have that percentage and play a good amount of games. And in order to do that, you have to get over the ladder anxiety. But I'm never going to tell you guys just to get over it. That's why you need to improve your self-efficacy because it's a proven way to reduce anxiety about future tasks. The next thing that I'm going to do is I'm going to say expand your comfort zone. If you guys have ever seen a comfort zone, look something like this. And guys, I apologize. I did not make this. So anyone who's colorblind, there are three separate colors there. And again, I'm sorry. But that is a comfort zone. So in a comfort zone, you're going to have three major areas. You're going to have your comfort zone, which you have no anxiety, no stress in. Your optimal performance zone, which you might have very low anxiety and you have manageable stress. Then you have your danger zone, where you have a lot of anxiety and a lot of stress. The goal is to stay in your optimal performance zone for as long as possible. And then when you're done, to retreat to your comfort zone. Then the perfect goal is to expand your comfort zone by going from your optimal performance zone, peeking into your danger zone a little bit, and then coming back to your optimal performance zone, and then retreating into your comfort zone while you're waiting in between things. So essentially, your comfort zone you should be in about 50% of the time, optimal performance zone about 45% of the time, and then your danger zone about 5% of the time. The more you're in your danger zone, the more it's going to grow your other two zones. And the more you're in your optimal performance zone, it grows your comfort zone because you're going to, the more you do something, the less stress it's going to cause because you're so used to it. And if you're, let's say, for example, you're doing public speaking, which is something that I've trained for a long time. People are nervous speaking in front of 10 people. But if suddenly you're speaking in front of 100 people, you're going to be less nervous speaking in front of 10 people because your subconscious is going to go, whoa, we've done way worse than this and we were perfectly fine. We can handle this. And that's what's really going to help out with stress and anxiety is expanding your comfort zone is a mix of improving your self-efficacy as well as improving your hardiness by doing spikes of heavy stress and then going back down into your healthy stress, which is going to be your best way to expand that. There's a lot of studies on comfort zones and there's a lot of things you guys can do about it. So I'm going to show you guys really quick what I would recommend. So what's going to end up happening is, let's say, for example, I'm going to use all of these colors are really bad for this, but let me just use blue. So in your comfort zone, let's say that you're here and your comfort zone is quick match. What you need to do is you need to make it slowly into optimal performance zone, which is going to be like your ranked, but just a couple ranked games. And if you're not even there yet, let's say your comfort zone is versus AI and your optimal performance zone where you still get a little nervous and stressed is quick match, then what you need to do is you need to make small bursts into ranked and then small bursts out of ranked, small bursts into ranked, small bursts out of ranked. This is going to make the quick match feel like it's less stressful. So then the quick match is gonna move into your comfort zone and your comfort zone is going to grow to more opportunities. Then ranked is slowly gonna make it into your optimal performance zone, which then is going to be something that will always bring you a little bit of stress and a little bit of anxiety, but not too much. If you wanna reduce it further, you can actually make ranked into your comfort zone by expanding into the new danger zone. And you might be going, well, what's the new danger zone? The new danger zone is when you enter the competitive scene. And the competitive scene is going to be, in the case of Heroes of the Storm, you could go into Nexus Gaming Series in North America. You can join any rank in there. Let's say that you're low rank. You can join some of the lower divisions. And those will only play against other lower division teams. So you get to only play against teams that are around your rank, but in a more competitive environment where you might even have your game streamed live. So let's take a peek. We go into team recruitment or Nexus Gaming Series. Look, Nexus Cats Division D, which is the lowest division, is looking for a healer main. Guys, I have a million videos on healers. you can become a healer main tomorrow, just watching all of those videos. They practice on Mondays, so if you have your Mondays available, then you're good to go. If there's no teams recruiting right away, feel free to do a free agent application and throw that in there. Then if you're in Europe, there's Heroes Lounge, and if you're playing any other game and you happened upon this video, well, guess what? You can also expand by going into the competitive scene, and suddenly this will allow you to go from the danger zone, which is going to be competitive play, and it's going to move ranked into your comfort zone. And then if there's further out, and again, remember, your optimal performance zone is now, and between this area is going to be where that competitive is. It's still going to be nerve-wracking. But then there's bigger tournaments. There's prized tournaments. You do a couple prized tournaments, and suddenly these other tournaments are less anxious for you. They move into your optimal performance zone. Scrims, where you play against competitive teams and competitive play, there's nothing really at stake, but you're trying to learn and improve new team comps, which is going to make that your optimal performance zone. So guys, that is number two. That is your second option for getting rid of ladder anxiety, is expanding your comfort zone to where the ranked is in your comfort zone. Now, plan three, change your mindset. Guys, I'm not really ever nervous about losing rank because my mindset in this game is not to use rank as a bragging right. My ranked for me in every single game that I play is to see my improvements. Currently in Overwatch, I am not upset to say that I am around gold at the moment because I have moved up from bronze. So the reason why this is important to me is because I will jump into ranked immediately so that I can see my improvements. When I hit a plateau, what do? I learn new things, then I improve further and I hit a plateau, and then I practice my mechanics, and then I move up and I hit another plateau. And I loved using ranked instead of a bragging right as a tool to see how I'm improving and to always move forward. Now, this is going to be one of the most difficult or the most easy plans, depending on who you are. In life, if you're in a situation where you're already confident about something else and you're already happy about other things, and you already have other bragging rights, it's gonna be really easy to go, I don't really need to worry about this. Like, I'm already an artist, I'm already a pilot or whatever. Like, I already have this great career. I don't really need to worry about this, but I'd love to see myself improve at something other than the thing that's my actual career or hobby, like, or whatever. Like, I want to see improvements. Like, I want to see if I can still improve. This one person came up to me, they're like, oh, well, I'm older, so I can't learn new things. And I showed them a study that said, I said, what age do you think people can learn new things? Like 20, 25? And they're like, yeah, 20, 25 seems pretty good. So I showed them a study that showed that people that are in their 70s can learn at a rate of 80% compared to someone that's in their 20s. So that means that they can still learn new things. It's their subconscious that's holding them back. And sometimes that's all it is. People just don't understand that. So it's nice to be able to prove to yourself that you can still improve at something. Now, naturally, the reaction times and all of that are just going to get worse. But that's why you try to adapt in other ways. Use macro. My reaction times have always been really bad. It's probably why I was terrible at sports. But I've been able to improve and hit grandmasters using macro play, using strategy instead of mechanics. And it's the same thing that I do in Rainbow Six. I'm terrible at shooters and I'm with terrible reaction time, but oh man, can I set up a situation to where I'll see the other person before they see me. And so you want to do that as much as possible to try to improve. With that being said, changing your mindset is going to be one of the easiest ways to break away from this ladder anxiety, because you don't care about your rank for your rank anymore. You only look at your rank as a indicator rather than a something that is who you are. So with all of that being said, guys, that is the what anxiety is, what are the psychological tools that affect anxiety, and my three plans that I would recommend. And they're all based off of research that has been used, as well as they're all tools that I've used to help people in public speaking, as well as in other aspects of their life. So with that being said, if you guys have any questions about that or you'd like to see more videos on psychology, let me know in the comments below. I'd love to hear about it. I still want to do more videos of psychology behind gaming on a bunch of different games, but I've just been very busy with school and work, so it's going to be a little bit. But thank you guys so much for watching, and feel free to check out any of my other videos.